Well, this evening, I'd like to read the account of our Lord's temptation in the wilderness, where he was confronted with the enemy to see what the enemy was seeking to do to him, which is essentially what he was seeking to do to Eve, as we saw this morning. But how unlike Eve, our Lord Jesus Christ was able to repel the enemy through correct understanding of the Word of God. And what we have here is really an example of the use of that one particular piece of the armor of God that Paul talks about in Ephesians 6:17, the sword of the Spirit. If we are to fend off the enemy, not only defensively, but also offensively, we need to be able to use the word as our Lord did. What he did here was not only for our salvation, but it was also an example to us that we would be able to do what he did. So let me begin by reading Matthew chapter 4 in verses 1 through 11. This is just after the baptism of our Lord Jesus Christ. We read, then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And after he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he then became hungry. And the tempter came and said to him, if you are the Son of God, command that these stones become bread. But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Then the devil took him into the holy city and had him stand on the pinnacle of the temple. And said to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. Jesus said to him, on the other hand it is written, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test. Again the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, all these things I will give you if you fall down and worship me. Then Jesus said to him, go, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God and serve him only. Then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and began to minister to him. May the Lord bless his word to our understanding and to our growth in grace, and may encourage us to be able to become skillful in the Word of God so that we might be able to repel the enemy. Now, this morning, remember, we were considering one of the main ways our enemy attacks us, and again, this isn't the only way, but this is one of the main ways. This is certainly the way that he attacked Eve, and we see him attacking Jesus, and that is through deception. We were reminded that his once great wisdom that he possessed as the greatest creation of God, that anointed cherub that covers, is now corrupt. And instead of using that wisdom to serve and honor God, he now tries to deceive and destroy those who are made in the image of God, that is, he seeks to destroy us. He was able to get Eve to sin. And he did it again through the Word, by essentially making her first of all doubt God's Word. He comes to Eve and he says, has God said? Has he really said this? Is this really what he meant? He then tried to confuse the issue a bit further by asking the question, has indeed God told you not to eat of any of the trees of the garden? Did he make all of these wonderful trees bearing such delicious fruit, only to tell you that you may not eat from them? Again, confusing the issue because there was really only one tree that the Lord told them not to eat of. The devil argued God's love. Surely, if you eat of the tree, you will not die. God loves you too much. He's too gracious to carry out such a harsh sentence. And the enemy also, of course, questioned God's goodness. God knows that when you eat of this tree, in the day that you eat from it, you will be like him, knowing good and evil. God is purposely withholding something that would be good for you. God is not good. And so, as a result of the way that Satan was twisting the word of God, Eve no longer felt the force of the command. The command was clearly, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you shall not eat. That's plain enough, isn't it? She no longer took the threat seriously. For in the day that you eat from it, you will surely die. The only thing that Eve could see now, after Satan had twisted God's truth, was that the tree was good for food, beautiful to the eyes, and desirable to make one wise. By the way, this is exactly what the devil does with the things of the world that we shouldn't have either, tempting us to go after them. He makes these things that are bad for us actually appear good. And so when he did this to Eve, she ate, she gave to her husband, he ate, and in doing so, we know, brought ruin upon the entire human race, all the difficulties, struggles, warfare, bloodshed, disease, all the evil that is in the world today emanates from this first sin. Now, the devil, as well as our flesh, again, we have an external enemy and an internal enemy, are working to do the same thing to us, to try to destroy us. They're trying to get us to doubt what God says. To become confused about the issues, to question the consequences, and to convince us that it's in our best interest to do what God tells us not to do. And to the degree that he is successful, we saw that our communion with God is weakened. Now I'm talking about as Christians. We will not be destroyed by the enemy. He cannot destroy us, but he can certainly do a lot to injure us. And what he will do is weaken our communion with God. And when he weakens that communion, he also weakens our ability to serve the Lord. And when he weakens our ability to serve him, not only does the kingdom not advance through our efforts, but the reward that we would hope to receive in heaven becomes less. But to the degree that we are successful in defending ourselves against the devil's attacks and the flesh, and staying on the right path, that communion is strengthened, and so our service, and so our reward becomes greater. So tonight what I want us to consider is how we are to defend ourselves against the devil's attack when it comes from this particular quarter. And that is by countering his deception with God's truth. Now again, there's more that goes into this, but we do need to at least see this point. We need to understand what God says. We need to understand it clearly and not let the enemy deceive us. Now we see the perfect example of how we are to do this in Jesus' encounter with the devil in the wilderness. So that's what we want to look at now. Now, in our passage, we read that after Jesus was baptized, remember he was baptized by John. John points him out as the Lamb who takes away the sins of the world. The heavens open. God speaks. This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. The Spirit of God descends. That Jesus was baptized not just with water, but he was also baptized with the Holy Spirit, anointing him for his ministry, anointed with the Spirit above measure, which means without measure. He's the one to whom the Spirit has been given in its fullness. But after that takes place, the first thing that happens is the Spirit leads him into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. Now we know that this is an example for us, that Jesus, of course, is showing us here how to repel the enemy. He's showing us what to do when we encounter these same difficulties. But we also need to understand that Jesus did this because he needed to do this as our covenant head, as our Redeemer. He had to do what Adam really was given to do, but he failed to do. Remember, we saw, I think it was last week, when God placed Adam in the garden, that he gave them the responsibility not only of cultivating the garden, working and tending the garden, which means that, of course, work was actually a part of our original creation in the image of God. It wasn't just easygoing. Work is not a part of the creation or a part of the curse on the creation. It's harder now. But work was a part of what God originally intended us to do, and that work was really to subdue the earth and to make it bring forth what it was capable of doing for the glory of God. But Adam had another responsibility, and that was to keep the garden or to guard the garden. The garden, as we also saw last week, was God's sanctuary. It was God's temple. Adam was essentially the temple guard. It was his duty to repel any intruders that might come into this holy sanctuary of God. But we saw that when Satan entered the garden, instead of repelling him, instead of driving him away, he listened to him, disobeyed God, and he ruined all of us. But now the second Adam, as the head of a new race, the one who was to guarantee the blessings of the covenant for us, he had to do precisely the same thing. He had to face the tempter and overcome him for us. He had to do what Adam essentially failed to do. Now, notice just a couple things about this before we get into the actual temptations and what it is that Jesus did to fend him off. Notice, first of all, that Jesus faces the devil in this wilderness. Adam's battle took place in a garden, in a very lush environment, untouched by sin, a very beautiful place. But the fact that now Jesus is in the wilderness facing off against the enemy reminds us that Adam's failure destroyed the creation and essentially made it desolate. So now Jesus is facing the devil in a desolate place. This whole world would have been a garden if Adam had not failed. And I want you to notice, too, that the Spirit of God prepared him for this encounter by putting it on his heart to fast and prepare himself for 40 days. We read in the Old Testament that Moses, the mediator of the Old Covenant, also fasted in the wilderness for 40 days and 40 nights as he prepared to receive God's law. So the mediator of the new covenant, our Lord Jesus Christ, did the same as he prepares to overcome the devil's temptations to break that law in order that he might bring that law to his people and really not just bring it on stone, on tablets of stone, but that he might, by his Holy Spirit, write it upon our, or put it in our minds and write it upon our hearts, give us the ability actually to keep it. Well, after these 40 days, Jesus becomes hungry, and the tempter comes to him. And the tempter begins with the temptation, which seems perhaps calculated most likely to succeed. We read in verse 3, and the tempter came and said to him, if you are the Son of God, command that these stones become bread. Now Jesus was hungry. And likely would want to eat, which is why this temptation seems like the one that would be most likely to be brought to him first. Now the devil says, if you are the Son of God, we need to understand that the devil knew who Jesus was. We know that the demons, when they saw Jesus, immediately recognized him. We read of Legion in Luke 8:28, seeing Jesus, He cried out and fell before him and said in a loud voice, What business do we have with each other, Jesus? Son of the Most High God, I beg you, do not torment me. The demons not only, of course, knew who he was, but they also knew who they were before him. And so Legion fell down before him. And pled for mercy because he knew that Jesus had the power to cast him into the pit. If you come to torment us before the time. Satan certainly knew who Jesus was. As a matter of fact, Satan had earlier tried to kill Jesus when he was an infant. And that through, of course, Herod. So the devil wasn't saying, if you are the Son of God, but he is essentially saying this, since you are the Son of God, command that these stones become bread. Now, I don't think there was anything necessarily wrong with Jesus doing what Satan had said. I mean, later on, he's going to essentially create fish and loaves from that small lunch that child had and feed 5,000. On another occasion, feed 4,000. That's something Jesus could do, perfectly capable, being the Son of the Most High God. His fast was over. This temptation was at hand. There was no reason why he couldn't do it except for this reason. The devil wanted him to do it. And he wanted him to do it to prove himself. And Jesus did not need to prove himself before the enemy. He was not the devil's puppet. And so how does Jesus repel him? And here's, of course, what we want to see. He does it through God's word. Notice what he says in verse 4, Matthew chapter 4. But he answered and said, "It is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God." Now, I think it's interesting that Jesus uses this opportunity not only to repel the enemy, of course, with God's truth, but also to give us the key on how we can overcome all of the devil's temptations by using the principle that Jesus essentially had been living by his entire life, certainly for the past 40 days, and would for his remaining time on earth. And the principle is essentially this, that the physical isn't all that there is. It's not the only thing that is important. There is something really that is more important. That we are not to concern ourselves with essentially the same things that unbelievers concern themselves with. There's something more. Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount, in chapter 6, verses 31 and 32, "Do not worry, then, saying, what shall we eat? Or what will we drink? Or what will we wear for clothing? For the Gentiles eagerly seek all these things. For your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. Man shall not live by bread alone. Man shall not have his thoughts and his mind only on this earth and the things of this earth and the things that we need for survival and even things beyond that. There's more than that. And what more is there? Well, he goes on to say in verse 33, but seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. This is what Jesus means when he tells us that we should live not just on bread, but on every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. When we live that way, we are seeking the kingdom. We are doing what the Lord calls us to do. There is more to life than what we see. There is what we don't see, and we need to pursue that by living according to the word of God. Now, again, think of this. If Eve had done this, when Satan came to tempt her, if she had listened to God and lived by his word rather than what Satan was saying, she would have been safe. She would have remained on the path. Adam would have remained on the path. But they chose to listen to the devil instead, and so they fell. What was the devil presenting to them? Essentially, the bread of this world. Instead of listening to the word of God. Now, the same thing is going to happen to us if we choose to listen to the devil rather than to God. Now, thankfully, by God's grace, we will not fall completely away, but we will lose something very precious, fellowship with the Lord, at least that closeness of fellowship that we saw this morning is very important. And when we lose that fellowship, we lose something of our ability to serve the Lord. And we don't want to lose it. And what is the difference between Spurgeon and us? Certainly it has to do with God's call, but it has to do with his devotion to the Lord. We may not have Spurgeon's gifts. We may not have Whitfield's gifts or Edwards' gifts and so forth. But we can have that relationship they had with the Lord. We can have that love. We can have that devotion. But it requires work. And part of that work is repelling the enemy. We must live by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. It makes a huge difference in our relationship with the Lord. Now, the devil tempted Jesus to show the Jews that he was the Messiah through a supernatural rescue. We read in verses 5 and 6. Then the devil took him into the holy city and had him stand on the pinnacle of the temple, that would be the highest place on the temple wall, and said to him, If, since you are the Son of God, throw yourself down. For it is written, he will command his angels concerning you,
On their hands they will bear you up so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. Satan is suggesting essentially this. If in the most public place in Israel, which is Jerusalem, that's the religious capital of Israel, at the temple, which is the center of their worship, if Jesus would go up to the highest point and essentially throw himself off, jump off, and the angels were to catch him, that would promote his cause by proving that he was the Messiah. Now, what's wrong with doing that? Well, of course, at least one of the things, it was not yet the Lord's time. If you look at the life of Jesus throughout the Gospels, you'll see that one thing he did was very carefully kept the fact that he was the Messiah a secret. And the reason he did that was because he knew his enemies, when they discovered that he was the Messiah, would want to kill him. So he kept it a secret so that he could minister, although he revealed it, of course, to his disciples. Now consider the effect that his 3.5 years of ministry had on the Jews, and consider whether throwing himself off the temple and being caught with angels would necessarily help his cause. For three and a half years, they saw his miracles. For three and a half years, they saw him cast out demons. And when he did that, they accused him of being in league with the enemy. They saw him raise the dead. And at the end of that time, what was the effect? What did they want to do to him? They wanted to kill him. And that is, in fact, what they did. Now, if Jesus had done what the devil had said, they would have wanted to kill him. Even sooner. So notice that's obviously not what Jesus wanted. And I want you to notice something else. That after Jesus had repelled the devil's first temptation, command that these stones become bread with the word of God, that Satan used Scripture in his second temptation. Oh, you want to use the word of God, Jesus? Well, how about this one? Why don't you go ahead and do this? Because this is what the word of God actually says. Now, does the devil ever use God's word to tempt us to sin? Well, that's exactly what he's doing here with Jesus. Of course he does that. But he always misuses the scriptures. Now it's interesting that in this quote, he is actually quoting a passage that had to do with Jesus. It did apply to him, but he was misapplying that passage. This was not how Jesus was going to reveal himself. This passage was not meant to encourage Jesus to put himself into a dangerous situation so that it would require the angels to come and rescue him. That's the wrong way of thinking. As a matter of fact, it's this kind of thinking that has led some churches today. Perhaps you've seen them on television, actually, not too long ago, them doing this very thing. A group of Christians testing the truth of their Christianity by drinking poison and by allowing serpents, snakes to bite them to see if they're going to survive. If they survive, they're Christians. If they don't survive, they're not Christians. Now, after all, didn't Jesus say in Mark 16, verses 17 and 18, These signs will accompany those who have believed. In my name, they will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. They will pick up serpents. And if they drink any deadly poison, it will not hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick, and they will recover. Now, you probably know there is some question regarding these. These verses and the last several verses of Mark are not found in the very early manuscripts. But if these are in fact the words of our Lord, he did not mean that we should tempt him by purposely putting ourselves in harm's way in order to see if God will respond. But if we should be forced to drink poison if our enemies should force us to drink. Or if we should be bitten by snakes, as Paul was in Malta, recall, when he got off the ship after the shipwreck. Out of the fire came a viper and a fast into his hand, and they thought when he was bitten that here's a criminal who escaped the sea, but God isn't going to allow him to live. But then when they saw that he shook the viper off into the fire and he was fine, then they thought he must be a god.
Well, he was bitten by a viper, and it didn't harm him.
Essentially, what the Lord is telling us here is that if these things should happen to us,
he will deliver us,
if it is his will,
but not that we should put ourselves in harm's way.
Now, the same thing is true here with regard to this passage that Satan quoted to Jesus.
If in his Father's service,
Jesus' life was threatened, and it wasn't yet his time to die, the angels would guard him.
Such as when, on that one occasion, just after Jesus comes out of the wilderness, he goes to a synagogue.
And he gets up as the visiting rabbi, and he reads from the scriptures
a passage about the Messiah.
And he says, today, this passage has been fulfilled in your hearing.
And they kind of, first of all, were shocked by the fact that he would even say that.
And then as he went on to identify himself with the one being spoken,
they decided he shouldn't live.
And so they dragged him to the edge of a cliff, and they were going to throw him off the cliff.
But then Jesus just turned around and walked right to the midst of them,
and he left. It wasn't yet his time,
and so he was protected
by his Father.
So Satan comes to him, quotes this passage of Scripture, but he is misusing the Scripture.
And so how does Jesus deal with the misuse of Scripture?
Well, in the same way that he dealt with the first temptation,
he uses Scripture against the enemy again to correct him.
We read in verse 7,
Jesus said to him,
on the other hand, it is written,
you shall not put the Lord your God to the test.
The Lord says we are not to tempt him
by purposely putting ourselves in danger
in order to force him to perform.
So when Satan comes to us and misuses Scripture to try to tempt us to sin,
we need to use the Scripture to refute him.
And then finally, Satan's third temptation had to do with the reason why Jesus came into the world.
Remember, he came into this world to become its king,
to take the nations back from the devil.
That's one of the reasons why, as I said earlier, Satan, knowing who Jesus was, knowing that he came into the world as king,
tried to kill him while he was still a toddler
to prevent that from happening.
But now having failed, he comes to tempt him to complete his work in an unthinkable way.
We read in verses 8 and 9,
again the devil took him to a very high mountain, showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory.
And he said to him, all these things I will give you if you fall down and worship me.
It's very interesting here because it tells us something of what Adam lost when he sinned against the Lord, when he fell to the enemy.
When he fell, he handed control of the world over to the devil in a certain sense.
The devil had the power to give the nations and control of the nations and their glory and their splendor to whomever he wanted
within the bounds of what the Lord would allow.
Remember, Satan is always on a chain and cannot go beyond what the Lord allows.
In Luke chapter 4, verses 5 and 6, there's again a parallel passage to what we're reading here,
and this is what we read.
And he, that is the devil, led him up and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time.
And the devil said to him, I will give you all this domain and its glory, for it has been handed over to me,
and I give it to whomever I wish.
This is the reason why Paul calls Satan the god of this world.
He has a certain amount of control.
And Jesus didn't challenge his right to do this.
He didn't say, you're a liar, Satan, you don't have that power.
God has that power.
He knew that had been given to him.
And neither did Jesus challenge the fact that he had come into the world in order to receive this very thing.
The world, the nations, the power, and the splendor, and the glory of them, although, of course, in a very righteous way.
But he did challenge the way that he was
to receive these things.
We read in verse 10,
then Jesus said to him,
Go, Satan,
for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God and serve him only.
Satan says, I'll give you all these things if you bow down and worship me,
but to worship Satan would not only have been blasphemous, Because only God is to be worshipped, it would have been impossible for the Son of God, since it would have been a betrayal of everything that he was. Satan is the one who must fall down and worship him, the way the legion did when he saw him, not the other way around. So again, Jesus repels the enemy's attack through the word of God, by again holding fast to the fact that this is the way things are. Of course, Jesus knew that, and he was reminding Satan of that very thing. One thing that Jonathan Edwards said about Satan, didn't Satan know that it was impossible for the Son of God to bow down and worship him?
Of course he did.
But being, again, having this wisdom with this corruption,
Edwards basically said Satan is the greatest blockhead
who has ever lived. That's what happens when wisdom gets corrupted. Satan thought he was stopping Jesus by having him crucified. And yet, by having him crucified, he actually completed what it is that the Lord wanted to accomplish, and that is our redemption through the death of Jesus. So we read the conclusion in verse 11.
Then the devil left him,
and behold, angels came and began to minister to him.
I think if Adam and Eve had succeeded in holding fast to God's word, the angels would have come and served and ministered to them as well.
But instead, what happened was they were thrown out of the garden, and the angels came down to keep them from re-entering into the garden.
But Jesus succeeded,
and they did come to Jesus to minister to him, because through his fasting and through this battle, it likely weakened his human nature, weakened his body.
And he still had much to do in order to defeat the enemy and to free us from his power.
And so the angels continually ministered to our Lord Jesus Christ and strengthened him for this particular purpose.
Now again,
the point for what we're looking at this evening is essentially this,
that if we are to overcome the enemy when he comes to deceive us,
Either by using the scriptures against us,
we need to be able to refute him with the scriptures.
Paul, as I mentioned before, calls God's word
a sword
in Ephesians 6, verse 17.
He says, and take the helmet of salvation
and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God.
Now he calls it a sword because we need to use it, I think, both in our defense,
to ward off the enemy's attacks, but also in our offense against the devil.
Swords were used to block blows as well as to give them in combat.
And he calls the word of God the sword of the Spirit because it was given by divine inspiration
and is made divinely powerful by the Spirit of God for the purposes for which God gave it.
Now, the particular word that Paul uses here indicates that this sword that he has in mind
is the kind that is used for close combat.
In other words, it's not a big scimitar that you can take sort of wide sweeping swings with and expect to hit the enemy.
But this is the kind of weapon that would be used when you're close up to your enemy.
And so it's one that has to be used skillfully.
Now the Lord has already graciously given us his word. We have this sword,
but it's something we need to learn to use skillfully.
We need to grow in our understanding of the word of God.
Now, the only way that we're going to grow in that is if we learn it.
We have to read it.
We have to study it.
We have to listen to it as it's being taught.
So we need to grow in our understanding of what the Word of God actually says.
But if we are to become skillful in it in the way that Jesus was skillful,
we also have to grow in our ability to apply it.
We have to apply it to our lives. We have to apply it to our situations.
We have to be able to recognize the enemy when he comes.
We need to see how he's twisting the Word of God.
It's just like A counterfeit, right?
How do you train somebody to recognize a counterfeit bill?
They train them by showing them the genuine article, and when you see it enough times, you recognize the other one immediately.
That's how our minds need to be trained in the Word of God
so that we will immediately recognize the devil's deceptions and counter it with what the Lord actually says in his word. Now, soldiers who fight skillfully do not become that way simply by having good equipment. They become that way by learning how to use that equipment. Our Lord Jesus Christ himself, we do have to remember that when we read about Jesus, we're not reading about somebody who came into the world with infinite knowledge and who knew God's words, you know, extensively and in infinite detail and already knew everything that he needed. He wasn't contemplating the secrets of the universe while he was in the womb of his mother. Jesus was fully man, and he had our limitations. The Bible tells us that he grew in wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and man. If you have infinite knowledge and infinite wisdom, you can't grow in wisdom. But Jesus grew in wisdom, which means he learned. So how did Jesus gain the skill that he had? Well, as a child, he listened to his parents, as his parents taught him the word. He went to the synagogue with his family and worshiped. He went to the temple, as we read in Luke's gospel, and he was asking the teachers of the law questions, and he was answering their questions. So he had to learn, he had to grow, just like the rest of us. But of course, he took what he learned, and he applied it to his life comprehensively and extensively because it was in his heart to honor the Lord his God most of all. And we know that Jesus stuck to the path and never varied. He did exactly what his Father called him to do. And every time the enemy came against him, he was ready with God's truth to repel him and to do the right thing. So if we want to overcome the enemy, if we want to be successful in the spiritual warfare, that we might walk closely with the Lord and grow strong in the Lord to be able to do what the Lord calls us to do, so that on that final day we'll have a great reward. We need to follow the example of our Lord Jesus Christ. We need to know the Word of God and become skillful in using it against the enemy, applying it to our lives so that we walk on the path the Lord would have us to walk on. Well, may the Lord encourage us to do that, and to grow strong in him, and to be useful to the Lord. That's what the Christian life is all about. That's why the Lord redeemed us. Well, let's bow for a moment of prayer, shall we, and let's ask the Lord to help us do this.